In this video, we're going to use Gauss's law to compute the electric field generated by an infinite thin sheet of charge with a surface charge density of sigma. Now remember, the units of area charge density are coulombs per square meter. So if you take that sigma and multiply by an area, it will tell you the charge enclosed in that area. So the first step in applying Gauss's law is to choose a Gaussian surface that shares the same symmetry as our problem. And the critical point there is that our electric field should have a constant magnitude over the Gaussian surface, and it should be perpendicular to that surface. So the classic choice of Gaussian surface for this infinite thin sheet is called the Gaussian pillbox, just a little rectangular box. It extends the same distance below and above our infinite sheet. And because our electric field must point exactly straight up above the sheet and straight down below the sheet, we're guaranteed to have an electric field that's perpendicular to that top and bottom surface. And we know this electric field has to be perfectly straight up if the sheet is horizontal, because it's literally infinite, which means there's no way to bias the electric field to the left or the right. So we label our Gaussian surface here and get ready to apply Gauss's law. So Gauss's law says that the total electric flux through this closed surface, and that's the integral of E dotted into dA, where each of those little area elements dA has the direction of the normal vector to the surface, in other words, the perpendicular. That total electric flux across the closed surface is going to be equal to the enclosed charge divided by epsilon zero, the permittivity of free space. And I'll post a link real quick to the video where we derived a formula for electric flux and derived Gauss's law. So we want to compute this electric flux integral on the left, and our surface was specifically chosen so that this integral sort of falls apart. First, the electric flux contribution from the side walls of the Gaussian pillbox is going to be zero. Because the electric field is parallel to the area elements there, in other words, perpendicular to the normal vector, there is no electric field penetrating the surface through the side walls. So this flux integral over the closed surface really just becomes the integral over the top and bottom of E dotted into dA. But that dot product is trivial by design. We chose a surface so that E would be perpendicular to the area elements, which means parallel to the normal vector. The direction of dA is the direction of the normal vector at each point. So the dot product just turns into the product of the magnitudes. And now I have the integral of E times dA over the top and bottom. But the electric field magnitude is constant along that top and bottom surface. Those surfaces are exactly the same distance away from the infinite sheet, and they're parallel to the infinite sheet, so there's no way the electric field could be changing in magnitude along those surfaces. And because E is a constant, we can now factor that out of the integral, and we end up with E times the integral of dA over just the top and bottom of the pillbox. Well, the integral of dA over the top and bottom of the pillbox just means the area of the top and bottom put together. Each of those is just length times width, so we end up with E times 2 length times width. Now we have to compute the enclosed charge inside this Gaussian surface. And remember, if we take this surface charge density, this area charge density of sigma, and multiply by area, we get the amount of charge. So we have this little section of area, this length times width, enclosed inside of the box. And that enclosed charge is given by our area charge density multiplied by the area, which is just L times W. So now we can put everything together with Gauss's law. Our flux integral turned out to be E times 2LW. Our enclosed charge was sigma times LW. And we have to divide by epsilon zero on the right-hand side. So now we can cancel the L and W, and we end up with an electric field of sigma over 2 epsilon zero. And that's it. If you enjoyed this video, or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left. Or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.